Okay, so my name is Sylvain Tourancheau. I'm from Mid-Sudan University, and I will present you a work which has been done in collaboration with three other labs, Acrio in Sweden, Ersin Lab in North France, and AGH University of Science and Technology. this work is focused on crosstalk measurements, so on objective measurements only. We try to explore what were the variation of crosstalk on time sequential stereoscopic LCD and how reproducible these measurements could be. So the context of this work, of course, as every presentation in this session, this topic is crosstalk. So as you know, it's the main display-related factor degrading the image quality. It's usually defined as an incomplete isolation between right and left image channel. And the consequences are ghosting, blurring, lack of color fidelity. Depth perception can be affected, as we've seen in this in the first presentation. And everything, all of these consequences lead to visual discomfort. And of course, crosstalk is due to many factors, which are varying according to which display technology you you consider. And there has been many definition proposed in the literature. In this paper, the question was how to characterize crosstalk for some specific case. There is no standardized procedure so far. One common crosstalk metric is to take into account, to measure crosstalk for one condition, which is the usually the worst condition when you have a signal of zero in the measured view and in the unintended view you have a full white image. And by measuring this signal, you can define this crosstalk ratio. Of course, those metrics are a good estimate of the crosstalk if it's a linear and additive phenomenon. But this is not true anymore for time sequential liquid crystal display, and as you will see in the following. So we focus in this work on time sequential stereoscopic LCDs. So what happens when you display a stereoscopic image on time sequential LCDs? So basically what appears is ghosting. As you can see here, you have the left and right image, input image. And as an output, you have the ghosting, that is to say this double image. So if we look more closely, you can define here four regions, in region one and three, the right and left image have the same values. And in the disparity region two and four, you have a different values. So if we look at the display temporal response for each of these regions, of course, for region one and three, you have a steady luminance signal, while on region two and four, the luminance alternate between the right and left value. And you can see here that actually within the short period in stereoscopic mode, the display cannot reach this steady state, which actually is the reference because it's the luminance when both right and left image have the same value. Of course, on those display, then the right and left signal are separated and guided in each eye thanks to active shutter glasses. So here is the temporal transmittance of active shutter glasses, and the multiplication or the combination of this temporal transmittance and of the display temporal response permit to obtain the in each eye the luminance signal as seen from each eye. And when you do then the average of those signals, you obtain for each region an average luminance, which is actually the average luminance corresponding to each region. from this average luminance values, a lot of crosstalk metric have been defined. They're usually called gray-to-gray crosstalk metric, since they are defined for each combination of right and left pixel values. I will not enter in detail there, but they are all of them are quite similar. They are usually taking in account the difference between the incorrect luminance with the reference one, which is the luminance when the same value, both eyes have the same value. So to summarize, the cause of crosstalk on time sequential leakage whistle display mainly depends on first the incorrect luminance, which is due to slow response time, so the display cannot reach the correct luminance within this time, and also depends on the the synchronization between the shutter glasses and on the display. As you know, the leakage whistle display are updated from top to bottom, and of course the whole display will not be equally synchronized with the shutter glasses. So that can also lead to a difference. So to fully characterize the crosstalk on time sequential leakage whistle display, we need to consider many conditions. First of all, the right and left condition, because of course this first cause of crosstalk, that is to say the slow response time, will be will vary strongly with right and left combination. And the second cause will vary with according to which position of the screen you consider. So how to measure crosstalk on this display? So the more logical or maybe more intuitive measurement method is to measure directly through the glasses. Just as it has been shown in the previous presentation, but in that case you face some problems, especially for if you want to do fast high sample rate measurements. Those measurements are very sensitive to the setup, for example, position and orientation of the glasses, the measured field of view. And they usually necessitate a complex optical arrangement to be carried out, especially when you want to do high sample rate, high frequency measurements. So we propose a method, which is a method with an high frequency sampling, in which we will characterize independently the shutter glasses on the display. And so the measurements on the display are close contact measurements, which are much easier to carry out. And then we will just synchronize both signals, so the shutter glasses signal and the display signal, in order to get the luminance as seen from through the glasses. So of course, the advantage of close contact measurement is that they are less subject to variation, easier to carry out, and that don't necessitate a complex optic. concerning the synchronization, in order to synchronize shutter glass temporal response and display response, we measure the synchronization signal which is sent to the glasses. So here is an example. The green signal is the synchronization signal directly measured on the infrared emitter, along with the shutter glasses transmittance. And if you measure the synchronization signal simultaneously with any display measurement, then you can synchronize the shutter glasses transmittance with the display response. And here I illustrate what I said before, that if you look at different positions on the screen, you can see that actually the synchronization between the display and the shutter glasses is very different and can lead to a very strong difference especially on the bottom right part, you can see that the moment when the shutter glasses are open, the luminance of a pixel has not reached yet its final value. So if we perform this measurement for any combination, any right and left combination, we obtain some luminance matrices. So as I said, they are obtained by multiplied the shutter glass transmittance with the display temporal response. And then we average the temporal waveform over a whole number of periods. So we get one value for each right and left combinations. So that make a matrix. And of course, one matrix for each position on the screen and for each eye. So this is an example of one matrix you get. So if there would be no crosstalk, of course, the matrix would be, every line would be similar. There you can see that the luminance is slightly varying. So this is for left eye position, and the left image value is varying on the x-axis, and the right image value on the on the horizontal vertical axis. And if we look at every position, again you can see some difference, particularly in the bottom right position. From those luminance matrices, we compute then the crosstalk. So as it has been presented just before me, we took as a reference the signal for which right and left value are similar, and this this luminance value corresponds to the diagonal of the matrix. So we choose to compute the crosstalk at the relative error, but of course you can use any metric there. And again, we will obtain a matrix for any right and left position, and for any position on the screen. So here is the matrix we obtain in the center position from a left eye position. you can see that crosstalk is varying according to a pattern which is hardly predictable. We got some, of course, there is no crosstalk on the diagonal. But we can see that we got some valley there with a variation which is really unpredictable. If we compare on the three different positions on the screen, again you can notice that the three matrices are very different. In the three cases, we can see that the main or the Eiger values are obtained for, of course, low luminance in the intended view and high luminance in the unintended view. So we try to study the reproducibility of those results in different ways. So first of all, the measurements have been performed in three different labs. Each lab used different instruments, and we measured the same display model, but three different samples of that display. the proposed method, which consists by measuring separately glasses and display, has been compared with the classical method, so when you measure directly through the glasses in one lab. And the proposed method has been compared across lab. Yeah. So if we compare the results obtained with the classical method and the proposed method, we can see that we obtain some matrices which are quite comparable. Of course, the results are not totally equal, but despite of this very strong variation and this unpredictable valley and pattern, we obtain some matrix which are quite comparable. If we compare between labs with the second method, again the similarity between matrix is quite striking. For each position, we obtain matrix which are, again, very similar. Of course, there is some slight differences in the position of the pattern. This can be due to difference in conversion from the signal measured with the photodiode and into the luminance value. So the results have been found quite comparable between both methods and lab, especially the patterns of this matrix are very similar, and it seems that the influence from the right left combination and from the position the measuring position on the screen. This influence is more important than the influence of potential differences in terms of setup from one lab to another on the differing instrument, or even the differing the different measurements method. But of course, from a measurement wise point of view, this is not sufficient. We need to evaluate this method with, of course, ground truth results, and if possible, with a golden sample and a calibration notice sent around across different labs. But these first results are promising, and the work is still in progress. So to conclude that, we've shown that the time sequential stereoscopic LCD crosstalk is varying with right and left combination according to a pattern which is hardly predictable, mainly because of incorrect luminance levels due to slow response time and because of difference of synchronization between different position on the screen. So crosstalk need to be characterized according to many conditions and cannot be estimate the overall crosstalk on a display by just taking a metric, taking into account only a few conditions. We propose the FAST method based on our independent characterization of both shutter glasses and display. And this method seemed to be consistent across laboratory and gives quite comparable results. But of course, a deeper analysis needs to be done to fully evaluate this method. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for an excellent presentation. Beautiful color graphics. We have time for a couple questions. Ray Zone.
Number two.
Hi, that was great. I'm just curious if you are aware of the full HD 3D active glasses consortium of manufacturers, and if there is a possibility you might be working with them, providing this research, which is key to what they're doing.
I'm sorry, is that, can you just repeat the question? I mean.
Okay, there is a recently formed consortium of active glasses companies, Samsung. Mm-hmm. These are companies involved in the displays, and they are all active stereoscopic displays. Are you aware of that consortium of companies?
No.
Well, I'm suggesting that that you might have a fruitful relationship, you and your university, with that consortium, because you have created a very useful methodology for what they're attempting to deal with.
Yeah, okay. This work has been initiated with the video quality expert group at the beginning, because we wanted to evaluate subjective crosstalk as well, but we realized that first we needed to have a good objective characterization of the crosstalk. And that's why we tried to find a methodology which was well, fully comprehensive and easy to carry or to reproduce from one lab to another. So that was the starting point of this.
Excellent.
Thank you.
One more question.
Here you go. How do you get in contact?
Okay, this is the full HD 3D consortium, and they include major manufacturers. The gentleman who gave the keynote yesterday mentioned the Panasonic's participation. These are all companies vested in active 3D glasses display technologies, and they are working to achieve compatibility among all their devices, and they're very interested in optimizing visually what they're doing, and this research would be very useful to them.
Thank you very much, Ray. We have time for one more question, if there's one.
Going?
There's one right there.
Hi, Rob Allison, York University. So in your graphs, there was these characteristic paths through the crosstalk space, you know, these sort of lines and that.
Yeah.
For certain grayscale transitions, is this due to the LCD overdrive, or do you have any intuition on that? Or?
You're speaking about the...
These characteristic...
The fact is, at this point, okay, it's not very visible there because it's an absolute... the crosstalk has been computed as an absolute value. But actually, as it has been shown in the presentation before, it's actually there some ump and some all. And of course, it's due to the overdriving. So at some... I'm sorry, I don't remember where is the hole and where is the hump, but in one case, of course, the luminance have been overestimated, and in the other case, it's underestimated. So that's why we have this zero crossing.
Any more, John?
No, we'll wrap it up, and thank you very much, Sylvain.